What's up, guys? What's up? What's up? It's Knowledge by Nikki at 9. It's a little after 9 today. I actually just had my workout session with my trainer. It was exhilarating. It was great. I feel 20. I'm way from 20, y'all. I feel 20 years old, y'all. I feel really, really great. And I am all about the success principles. I talked to you all for the last couple days about success and how success correlates in your language. You know, everybody has a different language. There's a book, old book, called The 5 Languages of Love. I've read this book probably 30 times to date. And it's interesting. And it talks about the 5 love languages. And it talks about how people love differently. And sometimes most of the time, where we make mistakes is that we try to love people in our language. So for those of you all that have not read that book, it's old. It's a really good book. I've seen the title where it was called The 5 Love Languages. I've seen the title where it was called The 5 Languages of Love. It's all the same. The point is, everybody needs something different. Everybody sees success differently. I just got off the phone with a person. I have actually, my oldest coachee, I was coaching this person way back, like 15, 20 years ago, when I didn't even have an official coaching program. I can't even remember where we met or how this happened, but I coach her now. I do the Reflections program, which is the custom coaching for her. That's where I come to you and I do everything for you, basically. And I was talking to her, and this is just to give you an idea about where I'm going with this. She has a successful business. She has what most salon owners / stylists want. She has everything that they want. She had a building, beautiful building that she was able to live in at the top and have her salon at the bottom. She tricked it out. It was in an awesome area. The building was off the chain. Financially, she ain't strapped. She doesn't have a bunch of debt. She's able to pretty much buy what she wants, do what she wants. She has a rock solid clientele. And I've kind of went into a life coaching mode with her. I tell her all the time, I'm her business / life coach. Well, she called me again to help her because she wanted to get rid of this building. Now, you know, most of us, we like, girl, you crazy? You got a building that you can live at the top and work at. And the building was off the chain, y'all. I ain't talking about no raggedy building. She was like, but I don't want it. And so I helped her sell it. And everybody in her life told her she was crazy for wanting to sell it, because it just didn't make sense. And I told her, I said, don't listen to them. Don't listen to them. I get it. What you have is what most people are aspiring for, but it's not who you are. She's a person who likes to be free. She doesn't like all that responsibility. She doesn't care. She doesn't want all. And I know that about her. So I had to tell her, do not tell anybody else about it, because I know if they get in her head too much, they'll make her switch gears. And she came back to me. She got a cash offer, guys, for this building. Cash. And I ain't talking about no chump change neither. She got a cash offer for this building. I got her to the point, okay, we're going to do this. And then she called me back like, I think I'm changing my mind. I told her, I said, if you do not sell this building, I will never talk to you ever again. I said, and why are you even thinking about it when you're going to end up back here? You're going to end up back here next week, and you're going to pass up. And they paid her over what she had bought, paid for, because she had tricked it out. It was beautiful. Parking lot. I mean, the place off the chain. So she finally took the deal, and she got herself free from that. So now she's got this rock solid. She went back into a suite, which is perfect for her. She got this rock solid business. No drought of clients. No issues with that. Busy every day. And guess what, guys? She's still not happy. She's still not happy. So I'm saying all of this because I have come to learn my idea of success, your idea of success, somebody else's, it's not the same. What she wants is she wants a family, she wants to be married, she wants to have children, and she's not old, but she ain't young either. She wants to have children. I think she's in her 30, 35 or something. She wants to have children. She right now, because that part of her life isn't what she would like it to be, it affects everything else that she does. Because in her mind, she hasn't really reached her ultimate pinnacle of success. Now, mind you, She has what this talk is about, had. She got things. The girl can jump up. She can jump up and go get $50,000 worth of surgery. She can do pretty much whatever she want to do. But she ain't happy because it ain't about things for her. It's about people for her. It's about relationships, whether it's friends, whether it's family, whether it's... So I now am working with her, which people was yesterday. And we had money was Monday, I believe. So now we're talking about things today, but I wanted to use her scenario to get you all to understand that want things, if that is really not your idea of success, I don't care how much stuff you get, you are not going to be happy. And I fully understand her, so I'm trying to work with her to scale back her days, whether she has to work longer hours, less days, so she can actually give more time to socializing and meeting people. And you know, I don't care, gotta join meetups, girl. I told her, I don't care, do speed dating, just have fun. They got a lot of single stuff going on, but she got to free up her time because she works like a dog. So I'm working with her in that regard because people is what she needs. People is what she needs. That is what's going to make her successful. People, even in a suite, I'm not even really sure if the suite life is really for her because she really needs the energy from people to feel whole. So we have to now work at that. We have to now work and help her get in that space because that is what success is to her. Okay, so that was Monday's talk. No, yesterday's talk was about people. Monday's talk was about if you just want to make money. You got to set your life up different. You got to set your business up different. Okay, let's talk about things. I have all of this too in my book called Booth Rental Versus Commission, which is on knowledgebynikki.com. That's what started this conversation. And I start off talking about what success is. You know, I get people ask me all the time, should I go booth rental? Should I go commission? This, that, and the other. And I tell them, there is no one size fits all. It's about what works for you. It's about how you view success and what working model needs to plug in to that arena in a professional, in a business world. But it transits over personally. So let's talk about things. I have so many people that I talk to that are maybe have been interviewed for coaching, whatever. Talk to them in some facet. And they say they want to franchise their business. They want to flip and go open another salon. Now, this is my thing. You want to open another salon and the one you got ain't working. I'm trying to figure this out. But there are things minded. There are people that they like, they want to maybe buy real estate and they want to flip houses. And these are people that if they're not managed, they can also become incredibly unfocused. Now, when I say focused, this is a different individual. This person is focused on the whole picture. They're not just focused on one thing. They're focused on the whole picture. But this is the necessary requirements for that person. If you want to have multiple salons or a salon with a lot of people in it, or if you want to do real estate, if you whatever this is, these are people that like the accumulation of things to increase their net worth, boost their ego, whatever the reason you want it for. You are going to have to be incredibly organized. You're going to have to be incredibly good at delegating. You're going to have to understand and learn everything there is to learn about a scalable concept or a scalable business. Meaning that you are going to have to think systematically. You're going to have to be really good with regimenting things or assigning. If you're not, you're going to have to hire people that are good with repeating systems and getting things set up. You're going to have to be really good at that, and you can't miss a beat. Let me tell you what you're also going to have to be good at. I talk about this in the book. If you're a salon owner and you like things, you really don't want people that like things. They'll dedicate themselves to a project. They'll do everything necessary to get it running. Once it's running, not necessarily running well, but once it's running, they really ain't interested in managing it and they want to go and do something else. They want to let that run itself and then go start on the next project. That is typically the mindset of this person. So you got to be good with assigning people to take over, watch your babies, do what it is you need to do. And guess what, guys? you're going to also have to really work on getting your personal life in order, because people that like things, they need to have better credit scores. They need to have better personal and business credit scores, because they're going to need to be able to get credit cards, say, that have large limits or unlimited limits, because when you got a lot of stuff is always going wrong. You're going to have to fix this over there and fix that over there and pay for the plumber to go there, and because you like to move around. You like to not be tied down to one thing. So you're going to have to be real diligent about getting your personal life, your personal credit, making sure whatever you need, it, you're going to have to understand possibly about what it means to do working capital loans, and what you're going to have to get real good in the money area. You're going to have to understand what financial statements look like, probably more than the average person, because you're constantly buying and flipping. You're constantly buying and expanding. You're constantly doing, and so you're going to also have to really be good at vetting out, I talked about this yesterday, a team that understands your vision, like for real, because you basically are going to be dispatching people out to handle all this stuff that you have. So you're going to have incredibly responsible people. Let me tell you a decision I made in my last 5 years of ownership. Now, I'm not the things people. That's really not what I am, but I still had to make this decision. And it will go for people that think like this. I knew I needed to be flexible in my salon that I had at the time. It was the last one that I had before I shut it down, and then I just dedicated myself to traveling, teaching, and coaching. I knew that I was not there. I was actually traveling out of the country a lot, so I was gone for extended periods of time. I knew I didn't have time to professionally babysit. I don't have time for that. I don't have time. I had never really done commission, but I knew it was going to be, booth rental, but I knew it was going to be necessary for me to flip the script and to go booth rental so that I can get people, so I didn't have to manage all of that and make sure that you do this and that. So I purposely, in the last maybe 6 years of me owning, I purposely said, if this is a things concept, but I had to do it for a different reason. I need people that are already responsible, that already can do stuff without direct instruction. In the salon, I needed workers that could work like that. And man the fort, when I was gone, I purposely interviewed people, and I changed my interviewing criteria up. I also have interviewing criteria. I have another book called Paper Makes Permanent, which is in my, that's also on knowledgebynikki.com. And it's basically a book that gives you all these different contracts and interviewing criteria and all this stuff. So you all check that out too. But I had to flip up the interviewing criteria a little bit, because now I'm seeking a particular person. I wanted ex-salon owners on purpose. I said in the criteria, I would ask all the necessary questions, and then I would say, have you ever owned? Have you ever owned a salon? This is what I was looking for, y'all. So this is what I want y'all to get. If they said yes, that automatically you in the running. Anybody who said no, I wasn't even interested, really. But if they said yes, I would ask them, what's the reason why you didn't own anymore? They would tell me whatever. It was all kind of reasons. I would say, okay, how many years did you own? Because this was the key. If they told me anything within 5 to 10 years, I on purpose was looking for that magic 5-year figure, then they were perfect for me. If they said 1 year, 2 years, or 20, I didn't want them. First reason is, you bailed if you only had a salon 1 or 2 years. To me, that says to me that you're a person that will bail, and depending on what they said, why they quit. Now, if they said because a parent got sick or something like that, that's different. But if you bail because something got hard in 2 years, that lets me know you are not the type of person that's going to ride through some stress. You're going to throw it away as soon as it get hard. I don't want that person. I don't want a person that as soon as times get hard, they're going to bail. That ain't what I'm looking for. I didn't tell them that, but that's what I was thinking. If they told me they owned it, it was really 7 years was that magic figure. If they said I owned it for 6, 7, 8, what I knew is that you had it long enough to feel the sting. You had it long enough to feel the stuff that goes on that you didn't realize when you was just a stylist you were going to have to deal with. And I knew that you tried. I knew that you really tried to hold on. because you went 7 years trying to make this work. And for whatever reason, you said, I can't do this no more. It's sucking up all my money, or whatever your reason was. I knew you were perfect because you felt the sting enough to man my fort and man it with an ownership mentality, which meant you were not going to do to me what other people did to you, because you remember what it felt like. And they would say it all the time. And you know what? People that used to own salons, they snitch too. I like people that tell. I like snitches that'll tell, you know, so no, because when they did that to me, that's all you used to hear. And I loved it. Now, I would not take the person that was over 10 years. You know why? Because the person that was over 10, 20, 15, because they feel like they know everything to do that's better for your business, and they failed at it. So when you gone, they gonna try to run your stuff. They gonna try to change systems. They will do stuff that is not what you wanted them to do, because they already convinced they could run your business better than you. They already convinced, even though they failed at it. So I didn't want that person that was fit to, because I ain't got time for you to be shifting gears and being a rebel, disobeying what I said, and I ain't got time for that. So that 7-year person, I'm telling all y'all, you want a franchise, you want to be able to buy and flip, those people are the people that you can give them a position. You can say, I delegate you to be the salon manager, supervisor, I don't care what you call them. You can barter rent instead of paying them. You can do these type of things with that type of person so you can move. So you can be flexible. You can say, I need to do something else. I ain't got time. I didn't do this. I built it. I got the system in place. It's now scalable means that it is a transferable working structure that anyone could learn and repeat the exact same way as you. That means I can sell this concept and somebody could buy it. They could set up shop just like me. And that is what allows me to start creating more businesses, more real estate, more salons, more schools. Well, I don't care what you want to do. That is what people like that, they want things. They want to see their portfolios grow. They want to get themselves set up to where when they die, they really have stuff to leave people. They really do. This is a person that has that mentality, is to build their net worth, is to increase their connections, whatever their reason is. But you gotta work under a different working model. Commission is not for that person. You don't need nobody commission, because it ain't gonna work. You ain't got time to babysit. Don't even entertain commission. If you got this type of mindset and you got a commission business, I promise you, they probably stressing you out to death. You feel like a hostage in your own business because you really want to move, but you trying to work this out because maybe you make more money in commission. Commission is for people who think in terms of, I just need one or a few that do really, really well. If you are in a booth rental situation, your thing is going to be about volume. It's going to be about increasing your bargaining power, increasing your financials, meaning where you may have 10 businesses that produce way up in the 7 figures. So now you are able to be beneficial to different type of loans and different type of things. But you may not make all your money in just one business. You may make all your money in the accumulation of all the things that you have. So if you try to make 7 figures in one business, that's a whole different thing as opposed to trying to make 7 or 8 figures in several. That's almost like Walmart. Walmart charges less because they think in terms of volume. They're trying to make a lot of money over a lot of things in a longer period of time. But another business, I'll use Target because Target is obviously higher. Target probably would, they make the same money probably as Walmart, but in a different period of time because their things are higher. Their things are more expensive. They're going to have a different group. They're not necessarily making their money in volume or in things, masses of things. They're making their money in higher price tags. It would be like the stylist in your salon, or if you're a stylist slash owner, you may want to make your money in doing less people and making more money, as opposed to someone else who's into the things concept. They ain't happy unless they got 50 people in their chair a day. They may not be charging as much, but this is the way their mind works. They prefer having more for less. You prefer having less for more. Whatever. Whatever works for you. It is a success principle that you have to understand comes with a certain amount of structure. You, your personal credit, if you want a bunch of stuff, you can't be raggedy. Your personal credit, because until you get your business credit established, which is different for those of you all who don't know this, until you get your business credit established, you're going to have to be a personal guarantor on a lot of stuff, meaning they still going to ask for your social security number until you get your paydex score up, where now you can put stuff straight up in your business name. You ain't even got to put nothing on there but your signature. All right? This is what you're going to have to do. In your business, you're going to have to get a team of contractors. If you have multiple salons, you need to get people on speed dial that anyone can call to fix the plumbing, to fix the electrical, to if somebody busts the window out, if I don't care what happened. If you got to get people where if you're not there, you got their names on a sheet of paper, on the phone, or in people's phones. This is who you call if this goes wrong. And it needs to be people that can come on a dime and get it handled. It needs to be where you got an account with them where they just charge your card at the end of the month or whatever, or they charge your card as they need to do work. You have to set up your business 100% differently. Commission ain't for you. This is also a person that may not necessarily need to be in a high overhead retail area. You may be able to be in an office suite, or you may actually be able to be in an industrial area in the truck stop in the back, because you also need to make sure that you hire established people that have their own clientele, period. You need to make sure you have established people that know how to build their own business, because you ain't got time to be helping them and what to do and how to do it, and you don't have time for that. So a suite building is probably the ultimate thing for you. But if you don't want to do that, you still want to do something where people are actually connected with each other, do a semi-private suite building. That's where you can actually get away with booth rental. I'm going to talk about that too in these contracts. That means you cubicalize them with no doors. That means you put walls between them. They can be convertible walls. They don't even have to go all the way up. Because you know if you go all the way up, sometimes cities and villages tell you to change the ventilation system because all these little boxes need to vent the same. You don't want to go through all that. You literally can build walls halfway up. Maybe I think convertible walls are generally about maybe a foot and a half, maybe 2 feet from the ceiling. Where the walls go up, they have their own little space. They have community shampoo areas, community dryer areas, community shampoo dryer areas. So you have kind of the combination of the suite life, but people still have to meet up in the shampoo room. They still have to meet up in the dryers. This is a perfect concept for how today works for people that like a lot of things. They're together but separate. And this now allows you, if you hire the right people, get people that are, no newbies here. No newbies. That means you got to literally almost say, I need people that's got at least 15 years in this game. 10 years in this game, and preferably been a salon owner for 7 of them, okay? Or say 15 years and been a salon owner for at least 7. You can come up with whatever criteria you want. Now, you don't have to put it in writing nowhere, but you know when you're interviewing them what it is that you actually want. And let me tell you what will be a great benefit to you. And I also have this part of this in another book I have online, knowledgebynikki.com with 1K. It's called The New Salon Blueprint. It combines a little bit of this concept I'm about to tell you. This is where you also, if you already have people, you already got like real responsible, critically thinking people that have been in an ownership position, you make sure that they interview them too. Matter of fact, if you have to set up individual interviews with each person, fine. Or if you want to do an interview, let your staff that are already responsible and critically thinking do a group interview. They gonna see some stuff you don't see, because see, they've been in your position before. They will be able to tell you, no, not that one. Oh yeah, she cool, or whatever. They'll be able to give you some insight that you might have missed. You ultimately make the decision, but they now become your board. They now become the people that help you run and manage your business, and you take care of people who take care of your business. That also is another something. You gotta perk them, and you got, because these are people that, when I had that situation, I had people in my salon that were in that criteria, and I was in South America. And I had a fly infestation in my salon because something died in the ceiling. We didn't know. We thought flies were coming in before I left just because the door is open all the time. Well, that wasn't it. It was something dead in the rafters. We didn't know. So, of course, we're gone. No, we weren't gone. We were still working. But that Friday, I think everybody got off early. I left, went out of town to South America. And then they sent me a picture back. By that Saturday morning, the place was totally infested with flies. Almost like how you see bees when they show you bees lined up the wall. Totally infested with flies. Not workable at all. So what one of the girls did, well, ain't nothing I could do. She handled it. She knew I was going to pay her money. She called the exterminator. She called everybody, said, we ain't working today. Normally, nigga don't let us work on Sunday, but that's cool. We working tomorrow. She won't trip. She ain't going to care. I'm going to go ahead and handle this exterminator. I'm going to get this done. Woo, woo, woo. She did it. Paid for it. Done. They emailed me. Showed me what it looked like. Emailed me the bill. Holler at you when you get back. That's the kind of people you need when you want to move around. You got to find them. They out there. All these salons being shut down, salons are being shut down at 15% a year, no matter what state you're in, because people haven't figured out how to do this thing called business. Yeah, we know how to do hair, but we haven't figured out how to do business, and that's where we're losing. So I was able to keep moving. I kept it moving. And when they sent me that, I said, wow, that was gross. And then when I got back, I squared them up, and we didn't miss a beat. But I knew I needed people like that because I need to be flexible. Even though mine wasn't about things, I was at a different stage in my career where I was busy building my personal brand as well as my business brand. So this was something that I just needed at that time. So think about that now, y'all. Y'all want things? Okay. And let me tell you something you also gonna have to think about. I just told a young lady this. I had a coaching session this morning right after I got out the gym. I just told her, I said, look, life is about adding and subtracting. And that's something we do not always get. We always want to add stuff, but we don't never want to subtract stuff. You cannot have one without the other. Every time you want to add something that costs more money, more time, more this, if you don't want to feel the pull, you're going to have to plan on, maybe I should subtract this first, and then I add this on. So it all makes sense and you're not stretched all over the place. A person that wants things, every time you want to add a new spot, then now you got to dedicate that same energy to that spot. You got to subtract yourself from the other spot. And you also have to make sure if there are things that are sucking up your financial resources where you can't still run this one effectively before you open that one, then you need to get rid of some stuff so when you do open that one, it won't be a situation where this one now gets left by the wayside, because I've heard that before, where stylists know you opening a new spot and now you done let this spot be whatever. You don't care. You don't take care of it no more. You don't do nothing because now your whole attention has been diverted over here. No. You want to have two babies? You got to raise them both. You got to raise this baby, and when you had a new baby, You can't deny this one. You still got to take care of this one. So that means if you got to get rid of some stuff, some bills, some whatever you got to do, hire everybody you need to hire, get everything in position before you go and birth this new baby because you want all this stuff, then that's what you need to do. But life is a constant sacrifice, take in, sacrifice, take in, sacrifice. You are constantly going to have to do that. And you're going to have to do that more than the average person if you want the accumulation of things. Y'all with me? All right, this is the success principle number 3. The first one is money. People just want to make money. You got to do stuff different. People that just, they want to build people. That's it. You got to do stuff different. Your whole working model is different. If you all want to know about what this is, buy the book. It's called Booth Rental versus Commission. And then I also have Paper Makes Permanent. I got a bunch of good books online. Or you can go back and watch the video, okay? The videos were on all this week. Go back and watch them. This one today is about things. And I'm talking about things totally different than what I've talked about in the past. Because if things are what you want, you're going to have to do things differently. Y'all with me? All right, y'all. Peace out. I got to take care of what I need to take care of today. I will see you all. I'm doing my videos now, my live videos on Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. That's when you all on there anyway, because y'all grinding on Thursday and Friday, so I ain't going to bother you. All right? I'll be in Nashville this week. I'm actually doing some photo shooting, and then I'll be in Memphis. And I'll be teaching my Color Me Crazy segment over in Memphis, Tennessee. You can actually go on 1-833-COLOR-ME, which is color with a K. And then you can find out exactly what address that's going to be. I'll be in Memphis on Monday. I'll be in Nashville all from Thursday. Then I come back after Memphis, back to Nashville. And I'll be doing some things, streaming, some other things. I'm going to actually be with my coaches. My coaches need me to come see them. I'm going to come see them so I can help them move along. I have three coaching groups, guys. I got Reflections, which is straight up one-on-one. I help you. I talk to you every week. I set up everything for, I do a lot more for you. That's a year program. If you're interested, go on my website, knowledgebynikki.com with 1K. You can book consultation. We can talk it out and see if this is for you. Then I have Stretch, which is for people that are actually going to be in, people that have owned salons for a little bit of time and things are broken and they don't know how to fix it. Okay. This is usually a lot of those that are still hostages behind the chair and trying to figure out the balance of both. And it's tough, guys. It's tough. Till you scale back from that chair, it's going to be a struggle. And I ain't say quit. I say scale back. Okay. Then Aspire is for those of you all that want to open a salon. If you want to open a salon within the next 2 to 3 years, holler at me. I'll see if you're right for the program. I interview everybody. Some I take, some I don't. Some I say, okay. You don't need me. This ain't gonna work or whatever. So I'm very honest with you. My job is to see you grow. I want to plant a seed and watch it grow. And I'm a change agent. I'm not a person that do a lot of talking. I had a friend of mine tell me the other day, I had given him a new concept that I was working on. And he said, Nikki, you are absolutely a genius. I ain't no genius. You know why I ain't no genius? The only difference between me and you is not how much we know. It's the fact that I'm willing to act on that which I know. What you know is nothing if you don't do nothing with it. I told him I ain't no genius. I said, I talk to people every day that have some of the most awesome ideas I have ever heard, but they sit on them. That's the difference. I ain't scared to try. I ain't scared to fail. I ain't scared to go backwards if it take me to. I'm not afraid to try. Nothing beats a failure but a try. That's it. I told him that's the only difference between me and everybody else I talk to is I'm not afraid to try what my mind comes up with. That's the only difference. I ain't no genius. I think I'm smart, but I ain't no genius. You all have great ideas. You have great visions of things inside of you, but you sit on them. You just don't do nothing with them. So then ain't nothing gonna happen. That's the only difference with me and you is that I don't sit on stuff. I think it, and I think it for a while usually. I try to plan it out. When's the right time? I ask myself, what does it require? What do I need to get this done? Do I need more money? Do I need more people? Do I need more knowledge? Do I need all of that? I do the homework. I research. Let me figure out. Let me see how this would play into what I'm already doing, which means if I think it's something that's great, okay, what do I need to subtract? Do I need to get rid of this before I possibly add this on? That's the only thing that I do. I process what's needed. I take calculated risk. That means I've thought about it. I say, okay. And then I know God says, okay, now's the time. But I've done the work. I've done the homework. I've done the scaling, whatever it needs. I've done that, and now I'm ready to move. That's the only difference between me and some of you is that I do the work, and then I move. I ain't thinking about it too long because let me tell you all something. I do want you to understand this. I don't want you to jump off bridges anymore and do no calculations and ain't got no parachute or nothing. You jumping out the plane, just don't have no idea what's at the bottom. But I will tell you this, that you still are gonna have to do some things without having all your T's crossed and all your I's dotted. I have so many people that I talk to that are waiting for this, for something to be set up absolutely, unequivocally perfect before they act. That's just an excuse to not work. That's just an excuse to not move. Even though I do all of that homework, I do all of this, by the time I set it up, I still don't know how it's gonna end up. I'm still gambling, because everything isn't totally in place, because if it's something I've never done, I don't even know what's supposed to be all in place. I do as much as I know, and then I say, let's do it. Like Nike, just do it. That is what it means to take calculated risk. I've counted up some of the costs. I've looked at what needs to be done, and then I launch it. That means that I do not have everything figured out. I learn a lot as I do it. When I first started formally coaching, it's the people I coached that taught me all of what I needed. I had a great program, but man, that program did flip so many times and I didn't add so much other stuff because, whoop, I ain't think of that. Whoop, okay, that's what they need. I didn't have 5 out of 10 tell me. I learned that as I go. I learned about, it's you all that I coached that made me take a life coaching program. I had zero interest in life coaching. I said, oh no, that's too emotionally draining. But I realized in order to get you to move in your businesses, I had to understand you from a psychological level. What brought you here? What life coaches deal with your past. Business coaches deal with your future. Success coaches are in the middle. They kind of bridge the two together. I had to learn, I need to understand how this person, I need to understand that this lady has PTSD. This lady has learned helplessness. This lady has bipolar chronic depression. And I needed to understand what was it that was keeping y'all from moving. So if I learned that, I had no interest. And then guess what, guys? As I learned it and as I got more inclined with it, and I took a real certification course to get more understanding for myself, it allowed me to be a better coach. It is what really propelled me into doing a custom coaching program along with the other stuff, because I realized I got to deal with all y'all as individuals. Y'all got a different story, different path, different history. And it was just no way to create this blanket, formatted, templated process for everyone. It was no way to do it. So my point is, if you got something in you, you just as much of a genius as I am, but you gotta learn about it, and then you gotta move. And don't be so over analytical for some of y'all that you didn't talk yourself into it, then you didn't analyze it some more, now you didn't talk yourself out of it. I know some of y'all did. Quit talking. You didn't did enough analysis. Now it's time to do it. So again, whether it's people, money, or things, it is time to move. And I want to see y'all at the top. Deuces. Knowledge by Nikki with 1K.com. I'm out. I'll see you all on Sunday.